It's a great privilege and honor for me to introduce two friends of mine for this session, and it is admittedly an unusual theme, but not when you situate it in the larger theme of beauty, the idea of taste and gastronomy, and it's quite fitting that this is a topic that we would be focusing on as well, both in the sense that sort of gustatory taste is a kind of beauty that you can, that
your
you,
attention, please.
Apparently something's
the
happened.
Next sessions will begin shortly. Please make your way to the appropriate rooms at this time.
Make your way to the rooms, because it's about to begin. It's something that you can experience, a form of beauty that you can experience in a singular fashion, namely, through the sense of taste. And not only that, but food and drink become part of you. And fuel your and provide you with nourishment, and that I think adds a level of complexity and interest to this form of beauty as well. But not only in the individual sense, but also in the shared sense, because we share food, we share drink, and it allows us to experience beauty in a joint and shared fashion that makes it interesting and unique, and I think fitting for a conference that focuses on beauty in a comprehensive way. And we have two extraordinary speakers this afternoon that, again, we're delighted to present to you. First of all, we will feature John Besh. He is a chef and restaurateur dedicated to the culinary riches of southern Louisiana. His 12 restaurants include August in New Orleans, a Gayo Top 40 restaurant, and Wine Enthusiast Top 100 restaurant. He won the James Beard Foundation's Award for Best Chef Southeast in 2006. And was inducted into the foundation's Who's Who in 2014. He's the author of 4 cookbooks, including My New Orleans and My Family Table, Cooking from the Heart, and most recently, Besh Big Easy. He hosts 2 national public television cooking shows based on his books, Chef John Besh's New Orleans, which began airing in 2011, and Chef John Besh's Family Table, which debuted in April 2013. The John Besh Foundation, founded in 2011, works to protect and preserve the culinary heritage and foodways of New Orleans via initiatives such as Chef's Move, Culinary School Scholarship, and Milk Money Microloans for local farmers. John is a member of the Center for Ethics and Culture's Executive Advisory Committee, and most importantly, is the father of one of our Soren Fellows, Brendan Besh. I'll add also that John's wife, Jennifer, who is joining us as well, is also a member of our Executive Advisory Committee, and we're delighted to have her here as well. Thank you both for coming. In addition to John, you'll also hear from my very good friend, Alex Pitts. Since 2012, Alex has been the assistant winemaker for the Scholium Project in Suisun Valley, California. He's passionate about classical California varietals, attentive farming in the vineyards, and learning through experimentation. The name scholium, of course, comes from the ancient Greek word scholion, which shares a root with the word for school and scholarship. Alex is a classically trained chef who worked his way up through the kitchens in Arizona and California. Before entering the wine industry, he last worked at the French Laundry in Yountville and Cyrus in Helzberg. He lives in Berkeley with his wonderful wife and our also dear friend, Stephanie. The title of his talk will be Culinary Creativity Born in Tradition, and John's talk, which you'll hear now, is Faith at the Family Table. So please welcome both our speakers, Chef Besh and Mr. Pitts.
Oh, I love it when they say nice things. That doesn't always happen. Father Bill, glad you could make it all the way back from Ireland. I had this magnificent talk planned, and complete with PowerPoints, and then on the way here I said, we're gonna do it differently. After looking and seeing, talking about beauty and in how you're focusing on all these different aspects of beauty, I've been so caught up in that myself and really thinking about, for me, growing up, always wanting to become a chef. I grew up in an uber Catholic family, not to be confused with the Uber driver that I had today and my son, who I thought was gonna kill me. but as a grew up with a sense of a very real and living faith, and that's kind of shaped my life. Whether it's attending schools at a young age to the idea of service and self-service and sacrifice, and it's kind of like worked its way right into the core messages of my business today, which now consists of about 1,500 employees. And it's interesting. I whisper about it all the time, but very seldomly do I come out and talk about Catholicism and how it finds a role in what I do on a daily basis. Jennifer and I joke about it, and it's my subliminal Catholicism message that we put out there, and it's very simple. Because the table is such an important aspect of who we are as a people, and so much so that, you know, from the mitzvah in Genesis to Christ breaking bread with sinners of his day, bringing people together, using food as that tool to reach across and to build bridges. And there's so many parallels between food and faith that I don't want to bore you with all this. But I'm going to tell you a little bit about my story. I was caught up in the beauty of food. After my time in the Marine Corps, in a lot of bad food in my life, I decided to really focus my efforts on becoming a great chef and giving it my all. As I said before, part of what had me cooking early in life, or I haven't mentioned it yet, but my father was hit by a drunk driver when I was 9 years old. My whole life just kind of came apart. As he went from one hospital to the next, a series of about 2 years of moving around, I found that I could cook for him when he came home. I was 9 years old, and I would just make whatever. Loved to hunt and fish, and just fell in love with bringing food from its natural state, preparing it, and making people happy with it. And I saw at an early age that food meant happiness. And that is a beautiful thing. Fast forward years later, I knew I wanted to be chef. I went to school, did all of that, set out, opened my own restaurant. And I found that I was creating great food. I lived for the reviews. I lived for being one of the best and being known as one of the best. And it was all about me, 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 me. And then there was this hurricane that hit. Hurricane Katrina took New Orleans away from me. By all accounts, I should have lost everything. And that was something, and I have to say that because it was at this point, I'm still following my faith, and I'm married, and Jennifer and I have four very young boys, and I thought I had it all balanced, but the truth is, in retrospect, I was just caught up in me, caught up in creating beauty so that I could get the kudos that I was looking for. It wasn't until this chaos in New Orleans ensues and that I realized God put me on this earth for a purpose. I had talents, and I needed to use those talents to truly affect a better world, affect change in my neighborhood. I'd always been a fan of Saint Jose Maria Escriva and the idea that we're all called in our everyday works to make a difference. We're called to sanctity through our everyday actions, through humility, self-sacrifice, service, and in my case, hospitality. And so it was then that we started feeding people in the streets and marshaling all the resources that we could to feed the truly hungry. And it wasn't until I actually fed a hungry person that I made the conscious decision to, I've had this all wrong. We need to do better. I need to be a lot more, we need to, that's when the whole subliminal Catholicism thing really went into action.
we slowly, we didn't make a profit at August for years, but we kind of somehow we managed to get by. The people that came to help me, those first chefs that came back to help me feed other people for free, were the ones that would ultimately become my partners, and they would attract good people. And this, you know, those acts of mercy that they showed so many people in devastated New Orleans, and then the outlying areas after Hurricane Rita, and then Hurricane Gustav that would come even later, and you had just 10 years of what appeared to be, to me, to be like biblically proportioned, just this chaos that we were surrounded with, just trying to grow out of Katrina, made me really think about setting some roots and building a company founded on the values of Christ. We're consciously aware of that using our talents, we can affect a great change, and we can restore dignity and to the city and to the devastated neighborhoods and so on and so forth. I'd gotten really caught up in that for quite some time. What's that? Oh, Mike is not turned on. I'm sorry, I thought you could hear. Isn't that nice that I've got this great son working to listen to our office and culture. There we go. Alex, don't forget, turn on your mic. So all these years go in, I'm focusing on the restaurants again, focusing on rebuilding New Orleans, and it became truly, became so obvious to me that I had forgotten about my own family. Jennifer, you know, one day, picking up Brendan from school, and I saw that they're eating fast food, and I'm the chef on his high horse saying, "What are you doing? Yeah, we can't feed our children like that." And then she never married an Irish attorney without expecting a reply. And so she then turned back on me. "Well, I thought I was marrying a chef. And you take much better care of feeding your highfalutin clients than you do caring for and feeding our own children." So I wrote a book about that. I think the page in the first page of the book says, "Never question your wife." And I say that in jest, but it became this evolution of using, evolution of self-reflection and recognizing that we do have these talents, and to start to weave these talents, and I had used, but I had segregated parts of my life where, okay, I was a Catholic on Sundays, and I was a dad when I wasn't working, and I was a good steward of our food ways and culture. And it hadn't been until probably, you know, like the last 5 years that we started to just tie all these things together and stop creating these bubbles and barriers and walls between one part of my life and the next. And so, as we've grown, it's really become beautiful to see how using these talents, we could start to marshal more of these resources. We created our foundation. Our foundation's based on saving the culture of New Orleans. The culture of New Orleans is an amazing one. I'll just briefly a little bit on that. New Orleans is this great amalgamation of all these different cultures that came together in the city, brought, you know, your Spanish, your African, your French, and then the Germans, and all these different people that came in, all left an indelible ingredient in the proverbial gumbo pot of New Orleans. I noticed rebuilding after the storm and seeing the devastation to our poorest parts of our community, and just seeing vast amounts of New Orleans and the helplessness that existed and the lack of dignity that people were left with or that they would experience, that I'm importing well-educated white guys from all across the country to come to New Orleans to cook New Orleans food. And we have our own population of New Orleanian that can't find a job and that they don't have the hope. And so I'm riding high and we've got these great restaurants and we've won all these awards, but what have I really done to truly change somebody's life for the better? And so we started this foundation that would offer scholarship to inner city minority youth, those with the smarts and the tenacity, the ability to be a chef, the desire to be a chef, and make that $65,000 a year education a reality for them. In a city of such great, rich African heritage, we don't have any top chefs that represent that community. So I have an issue with that because we'll no longer be able to sustain our culture if it just becomes whitewashed. Only a privileged few are allowed to achieve a certain level of chefdom. So we started that. And I think one thing that I'm seeing, I don't want to go on about me and about the foundation as much as the way that when we started to really pray about it and think about it and integrate all these different aspects of food, faith, and culture, business, it became very clear what this, you know, how I need to manage, how I need to grow, and really keeping these core values much more public instead of the subliminal Catholicism, but much more public about why we're doing the things that we're doing. And things, once I made that decision, things just blossomed and grew, and what would ultimately happen is that, you know, we're at this point now where we're seeing all these great young chefs that we send to culinary school come back to their communities, and they are reaching out. They're using their tools. They're using hospitality in order to bring young kids, oftentimes the most vulnerable, into an understanding that they can achieve anything in life. And so to watch this evolution from chef cooking beautiful food to see how, if I'm a good steward of this, that the beautiful food, if I'm a good steward of the all these gifts that the beautiful food has brought me, then we truly have not only saved a beautiful city, but we're changing one beautiful life at a time. And I wish I could take some credit for it. Most of it belongs to my wife and the support that my family's given me. But then it also comes down to each individual wanting to sign up for, you know what, working for a Besh restaurant means that I'm working for something other than myself. We're working for other people. The idea that we're serving each individual guest is making a difference, and not just in a very profound way, becomes exciting for everybody who we hire and bring in. And so I think my biggest takeaway, and I hope that you take this away, is that we all are called in some way, shape, or form to evangelize. And I'm just a support cook, and I happen to evangelize just through cooking and serving and cleaning and taking charges of people's happiness, just those small moments that they celebrate all of life's wonderful days. And so whether it's foie gras and truffles, which I have some for you, Car, or it's a pizza, we need to use these opportunities each and every day to change a life in the name of Christ. Amen.
Hello everyone, my name's Alex Pitts, and this is my second time speaking at the conference, and I'm really glad that we picked 2 years in a row, that it's pretty easy for us who make food and make wine to tie it in, last year being freedom, this year being beauty. Poverty a few years ago was a little trickier. Beauty and imagination have a big role in my day-to-day. I make wine in Napa, California, And previous to that, I cooked for over 10 years, and I came at cooking through maybe a little more old school approach, like as a busboy and bussing tables and cleaning dishes and working my way up and finding good mentors. And when I heard about the conference this year being about beauty, I was excited to kind of explore where does inspiration in cooking come from? Where does creativity come from? And being a big history buff, I kind of want to get into the history portion of that a little bit. So what I want to talk about is the point in which a cook gets some inspiration and creates a dish. And that's an obvious question is why should you care, I guess. There's this idea of the Japanese call it Kaizen, and it's something that I've always been fascinated with. It's this kind of idea that if you focus on the minutiae of your day, that you'll somehow find creativity in the smallest things. I like to think of the barbecue pit master in this scenario, who comes to work each day and does the same set of tasks. And upon putting his wood in a certain pile and fixing maybe a water nozzle to a spray bottle, that changing out that spray bottle can be his little moment of creativity, and how that can somehow relate to your kind of day-to-day routine that we all go through. Let's go in here one moment. Before sitting down to write this, I read John Paul II's letter to the artist, which I felt like was such a great inspiration. And it's filled with a lot of really interesting things that have a lot of relevance in the way chefs think about creating, and are they artists, are they craftsmen? One quote from his letter, which is really great, is what is the difference between creator and craftsman? The one who creates bestows being itself. He brings something out of nothing, and this, in a strict sense, is a mode of operation which belongs to the Almighty alone. The craftsman, by contrast, uses something that already exists to which he gives form and meaning. There's this debate that happens a lot between cooks and maybe the wine and food writing world, where they say chefs are artists or winemakers are artists, or are they craftsmen? Is their craft more like a blacksmith than an artist? And I kind of want to go through a few different areas where you can see where maybe it doesn't matter, really, is if a chef is an artist or a craftsman. So I look at the first easiest source of inspiration and maybe where creativity comes from in the culinary sense, and it has to be nature. It's the obvious place to start. It's all around us, and I think Adam and Eve, the story of Adam and Eve, is an interesting place to start. Because you look at Genesis 2:15, and it quotes, "Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, 'From any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die.'" So you can imagine Adam out in the Garden of Eden looking for food, looking for things that are beautiful, just because we're sort of naturally attracted to these things, and bringing them home to cook or to eat. That same idea, moving back to maybe what is considered the best restaurant in the world now in Copenhagen, is Noma, which has taken this idea, this foraging idea, has really championed it, to where there's whole crews of cooks that before service go out into the field, into a meadow, into a forest, and they actually pick their produce for the service that night. I kind of like to think of that connection between Adam and these cooks, both essentially looking for the same thing, going out into nature and looking for beauty, that kind of first bit of inspiration, that beauty. Nature also has another side that creates foods for us, like the wine that I make, or cheese is another great example. You can imagine the happy accident of putting milk in a goat's bladder and then opening it up upon arrival and seeing these curds and straining them and eating them. Wine's a similar thing. You can only imagine the delight of someone finding their grape juice slightly fermenting, slightly bubbly. You get a little bit of euphoria from the from that juice. So nature is an obvious place to start. And moving from nature is something that is so kind of elaborating on Chef Besh's ideas is food born of necessity. And this part of cooking is probably my favorite. And it's something that I have always kind of been a champion of. And what I talk about specifically is cuisine built out of having nothing. So when you see people kind of pushed against the wall, you find all of these dishes. And every culture in the world kind of shares this thing, which is so kind of special. A mother with very few things like cornmeal and pieces of meat making something delicious. And it's these foods that have kind of stood the test of time, that no matter what level of affluence one obtains, we still crave that cuisine. I think there's a natural trend in cooking to feel like maybe if you get to a certain level or a certain skill, that you must push that away. But when oftentimes those recipes, things like tripe or difficult to cook organs and things like this, those perhaps take more skill and knowledge than the expensive lobster tail or caviar, which simply needs to be opened and served. These dishes also have passed down through generations through an oral tradition, which is also something really important. We didn't really write recipes until relatively recently. So much of these dishes were passed down from grandmother to mother to child and so forth. And my mom's in the audience now, and there are things that I can never really get just like she made. And I think that's the part that is so important to these, whatever you want to call them, maybe peasant dishes. But I don't mean that word to be derogatory. But it's something that I feel very passionate about, is keeping these dishes alive. But I digress a little bit. Of course, the other side of this coin is wealth does drive, in many ways, fine dining and culinary inspiration. It's kind of the downside of this industry, is it takes a certain amount of affluence to afford to eat at a place like Noma in Copenhagen. You have to fly there, dinner can cost for two well over $1,000. And we see then the wealthy kind of driving culinary creativity. And this really goes back to antiquity. You look at the Persian Empire under Cyrus the Great and then Darius after him, and you open up these large channels between the East and the Mediterranean. And what is immediately prized is all these things that once you could never get. Where in Greece the food is kind of based in frugality, where it's these kind of like hard breads and people eat kind of seasonal things from the earth around them, the wealthy start to look towards the East for all these beautiful things. And you see this happen in Rome and Greece and many other places. A guy who wrote an amazing book at the time was Athenius of Naucratis, Naucratis being one of the first cities in Egypt, from a Greek city in Egypt. And Athenius wrote this book that's 15 books long or so, essentially about the conversation at a dinner party of this man who's a rich book collector. And so you get to see, it's a kind of a fly on the wall perspective of what the dining table looked like in 300 BC. And it's interesting, you see that food is now, and even then, if you are a man of certain means and you have, you're educated, then you must pay attention to the table. And you see cooks start to become prize, which is an interesting thing. He writes about cooks, this is just too good. The good cook must penetrate nature, know something about medicine, about the seasons, the setting and rising of the stars, in order to prepare food that is nourishing and will be properly digested and exhaled, which is a kind of interesting thing that I don't feel like we stress enough in culinary schools. He also tells a great story of a technique that chefs use all the time now, trompe-l'oeil, which is this idea of kind of confusing with food, like maybe masking something as something else. And he tells the story of this king, Nicomedes from Bithynia. Nicomedes is 12 days from the sea, and he craves anchovies. So his cook poaches anchovies and arranges them so to look like an anchovy, seasons them with olive oil and salt and sesame, and the cook, or the king is quoted saying, "The cook and the poet are just alike. The art of each lies in his brain." So we've now kind of seen the nature necessity side, and then obviously wealth driving creativity in the kitchen. But here, even then, we see this pop up, this theme of the cook as the artist. This same sort of theme of the rich kind of driving what people eat carries on for quite some time. And it really isn't until in France, under the guild system, where we're now, I don't know, 14th, 15th century, that we see dishes start to be created from the chef without any begging of a king in the sense of this, the anchovy story. Now we have the chef as the star creating food that is now desired by the whole kingdom. The first of these men to do this is Guillaume Tyrell, is the guy's name. And his nickname is Talleyrand, which is, I guess, the name for a small sail. And Guillaume writes really the first collection of French recipes and gets that all into one place. And the food we wouldn't really recognize today. It's a lot of these thick sauces that are thickened with breadcrumbs and a lot of these rich, heavy, spiced sauces and soups. All these kind of very heavy-handed, kind of rustic, medieval things. And then the next guy that comes after him, this is now in the 15th or 16th century, is this guy named Pierre, Francois Pierre La Varenne. And he also is known only by La Varenne, which I love that these guys have these one name nicknames. I feel like we need to return to that. Talleyrand, La Varenne. But anyways, La Varenne is now the first guy who is really starting to refine and drive cuisine and inspire new cooks and invent new dishes. His list of cuisine he invented is giant, and one of his things that is so important to all of cuisine, but certainly to Chef Besh, is roux. This concept of taking some sort of fat and flour, putting that together, cooking it, and using that to thicken your sauce or your soup, which had been done previously as just adding crushed breadcrumbs to a soup or sauce. So La Varenne really started to do a lot of the things that you see chefs do today. And this is this idea that, you know, you're focusing on when to pick a vegetable, when to prepare it, how it should be prepared, this kind of delicacy, also packing fish on ice and keeping it clean, all these things that seem routine now, but it really was pretty groundbreaking. This comes up to the French Revolution and after the French Revolution. So I briefly mentioned the guilds. And the guilds, if you could think of them like a union, there was a union for each type of cooking. So for the charcuterie, the patisserie, all of these certain areas would have their guild. After the revolution, that's all gone. So then we see all these cooks and professionals almost in the open market, opening restaurants. And at this point, you see inspiration and creativity in the kitchen kind of kick into overdrive. And then we really haven't stopped since. The founder after this point, which is arguably the most famous chef in history, is Auguste Escoffier. And Escoffier was born in the late 1800s and then made his career at the Savoy Hotel in London. Previous to that, he had served in the army and invented this brigade system that is now the way kitchens operate, where there's the chef almost acting as general and then subordinate levels underneath that. And again, it seems so obvious, but at the time, I don't think it was so. It was pretty groundbreaking to run a kitchen that way, and it became so much more effective. With Escoffier at the Savoy Hotel, he creates thousands of new dishes. Really, no one before him can claim as many new recipes as he did. It's pretty incredible. He created the peach melba, maybe is his most famous creation, over a opera singer, Nellie. Her name is Nellie Melba, who was performing Wagner's Lohengrin in London at the time. And he of course, wrote dozens of cookbooks, and it just seemed like he had this infinite amount of creativity. I kind of fast forward then to Ferran Adria, who is in many ways maybe the one people point to as he must be an artist. If there is an artist and craftsman debate in the chef world, then Ferran Adria, who's from Barcelona, Spain, and owned a restaurant in Catalonia called El Bulli, which for a long time was the best restaurant in the world. In 2002, the Pellegrino Awards named it the best restaurant in the world, and he would retain that several times until Noma, which I named before, would eventually take that place. Ferran is one of those men who seemingly, without all of what I've mentioned before, without any tradition, he just is always coming up with new inspirations and new ideas and constantly pushing cuisine. And it's too fitting, the last dish he served at El Bulli on its last night was peach melba, which is so fitting that Escoffier and now Adria are kind of tied in this moment where they're, in many ways, they pushed cuisine so far, so fast in a pretty short amount of time. So Adria was asked kind of near the end of the restaurant, they said, Ferran, where does all this creativity come from? And his quote is so fitting, and it really does kind of tie all this together. He says, I fuel my creativity simply by wanting to do better at every little thing I do each day. And going back to the barbecue pit master, or really the man who makes ramen in a Japanese stall at the fish market, or any of these things throughout our daily lives, these routines that can seem mundane, there is creativity around us constantly, and making those little decisions that inspire something else and create something else, maybe that's the real source of creativity in the kitchen and in our own lives. So, thank you.
Time for questions. Please come to the microphones and address your questions to either one of our two speakers. I'll ask the first question then.
They're all one at once.
So here's my thing. I'm Italian, and what I like more than anything in terms of, in the sort of purest expression of gastronomical beauty to me, is taking a gorgeous ingredient and not transforming it into something that I don't recognize. And I'm not an expert by any means, but I'm just, this is one person's opinion. How does that fit into your understanding of what you're doing in the kitchen in terms of teasing out the beauty of the ingredients themselves, or if you're a more modernist person like Ferran Adrià, taking something, using heavy equipment and all sorts of liquid nitrogen and so on, to create things that are new and unrecognizable? I'm being Italian, I'm a bigot against that sort of stuff, and an aficionado of the more of the less interfered with kind of approach. What do you all think about that?
Alex, go first.
All right, I mirror your sentiment. And I would love to make the argument that it's actually more difficult, in a way, to just serve that one perfect carrot than the using all these machinery to blow that carrot up, then reconstruct it with using methocellulose, and which has probably been done before. So I would just argue that it might be more difficult and perhaps even more noble, but that's a philosophical debate.
But I would also question what the occasion is. We eat for any number of reasons. I wish we could say we're eating because we're hungry, but the truth is we're celebrating something, or sometimes the meal becomes the entertainment. And I love that. And I love the fact that I'd love to deconstruct things, but at the same time, I love the perfectly cooked steak. Where my whole mission with food ultimately depends on why are we celebrating? What is this table and where are we at? I often want to, it's my job to manipulate what nature gives us as little as humanly possible. And I think there's a true art to doing that, as Alex alluded to. And I think that oftentimes we think more is better, and sometimes it's fun. We have to ask ourselves first, though, who are we cooking for and why?
First question.
I guess I have a related question. For both of you, and it relates to the economics of this stuff. Chef Besh, you run a big company, and you talk about the value that your employees understand, that what they're working for and toward, that the culture of your company. How do you deal with the economics of it? You need to make money, and you're presumably making more money than most of the employees. And how do you deal with the cultural challenges within your business of the money? That's one question. And related for you, Alex, is
sure.
It's not just an affluence thing, it's a class thing as well, a socioeconomic class thing. So, so it's not just that it's expensive to go to Noma or to the French Laundry. It's that experience and the beauty that we can experience of food at that level and the experience of hospitality at that level just isn't available to almost all people who are just trying to make ends meet and go to McDonald's and other places where the food tastes good and it's cheap and it's bad for you. And culturally, what do you think about the impact of the limited opportunities or the different opportunities for people at the lower end of the socioeconomic spectrum to experience what you talk about, the beauty that we can have at the table?
Well, to field that first question, I think that, unfortunately, I employ probably 700 artists and people that they obtain their self-worth through what it is that they're creating. Oftentimes when it comes to me hiring a chef, and it's all about, they could care less about the money at a certain point. It's all about creation, and it's all about this art form. And to those people, I said, well, you can only have, you can only create if you're actually making a profit. To those that come to our employ because they want to make a difference in this world, you can only make a difference if there is enough of a bottom line to do so. And so there, it is this balance, and there's a beauty to the art of balancing creativity with the demands of the guests and rewarding your staff at the same time, and balancing food and service and wine and paying rent and paying for Obamacare, for instance, all of a sudden, you know, it becomes this incredible juggling act that takes more creativity than I ever knew. But it always comes down to making sure that everybody understands that the bottom line is what dictates what sort of a difference we can make.
I think to answer the second question, it's a little twofold. So in the first part, we still see, and I was just talking about this at lunch, where dining at these very expensive restaurants is still almost seen, even if you enjoy the food or not, you go because your class almost dictates so. It's like, I go to eat at any of these restaurants because I am of a certain class, and that's what we do. Even though you may sit there and hate the whole entire experience, it's still something that you see happen over and over again throughout history. And how the other side, how can people without the means even experience any of these things? And this may be a cop-out answer, but I feel like a big part of it is a return to cooking, leaving the line at McDonald's and going back to these dishes like polenta and sausage that they don't take a lot of skill to make, especially now where you can buy so many things almost already there for you. That sense of that little bit of creativity of making that same polenta and sausage 7 times, I feel like could be a dose of that for someone who can't afford the $15,000 or $1,500 to go eat at Noma, for example.
Yes.
At least hearing other chefs speak, they often say, oh, I went to culinary school and I didn't really learn anything. I could still make great food before then and after then. And then you hear other ones who say, you know, this is the best thing ever and y'all understand what I'm doing and I can plan out my recipes. So for sort of both of you, which one did you experience more?
Well, I didn't go to culinary school. Oh. That's okay. I definitely took the approach of apprenticeship and finding good mentors and holding on to those people and really soaking up as much as I could. And I've been hired a few times, too, that I can remember for certain that the chef said, oh, I'm so glad I didn't go to culinary school. Now here's the job. Because there is a little bit of this idea that they have to retrain you. But I don't know if that's true or not. I haven't really seen that. But from my experience, it has been a benefit to not have went that route.
I think, culinary school gets a bad rap these days, but it's necessary. And since when would education not be a good thing? In the case that I was just speaking to earlier, where we're losing, we don't have a certain amount of diversification at a certain level of chefdom, it really comes down to the ability, that education is the key. Needing to understand the nuts and bolts of the economics meets the arts and how it all comes together in a restaurant. I went to culinary school and shortly thereafter married Jennifer. We ran away and I made apprenticeships in Germany and then in the south of France and then came back. And the idea of mentorship is still, that's the nuts and bolts of how you train as a chef. Think of culinary school as, culinary school, you learn how to be a cook, but you have no real knowledge to apply. And you have no real value to the team that you're.
But losing that step of learning how to cook from a mother figure or a father figure, and that kind of being eroded at the home level, you
right.
almost need culinary school to now get you back to, I know how to handle a knife, I know how to handle.
And we're generations away from people even sitting down as a family eating.
Yeah.
So that's so foreign. Much less actually cooking the food. And so I do want to tackle one thing, because I have seen what I come across a lot these days. Now you have the rich and the wealthy who can afford to go work for free in places and work for this chef in Noma, work for this chef here and there, traveling the world, obtaining their training, but at somebody's expense. And so, and I see all these stagiaires come across my desk, and it almost frightens me, because I want somebody that's had to learn, understands the grit, the value of work, and understanding the sweat that it takes to become a master of your craft.
Thank you.
Up here, up top.
Well, I think food is so highly personal, and I would challenge you to say that one, again, it depends on why are you going out to eat. Sometimes you're going out to be entertained, sometimes you just want a moment with your wife, sometimes, and I wouldn't get caught up in training your palate. Food is to be used and to be loved and to be enjoyed, and I think that, yes, sometimes it's nice to have to think about it, but more often than not, it's something that you just want to relish and enjoy. It's this little, it's this gift that we have, and so to have to overthink it means you're probably not in the right place.
Alex, would you agree that's true of wine also?
Well, yeah, I get asked that similar thing a lot, with especially as these same restaurants that you speak of in Minneapolis, which is turning into a great wine town. You look at the list and it's filled with grapes you've never seen and from producers you've never seen, and it's all very foreign. I think you just have to keep tasting all of these things. It's a kind of dumb answer, but I think there is building, like John said, kind of your personal taste and just trusting that. It's not very easy to do. Obviously, it takes time, and it takes a lot of trips out, which can be difficult. But
expensive.
But I don't think there's a simple answer. But it's a really good question.
Yes, Neil.
Hi, I have a question. Actually, it's kind of a dilemma. With my degree in the process, for many years, I've been assisting with a Catholic worker, okay, feeding the homeless people. And at times, it's difficult because we only have so many ingredients, and then we try to vary it with the herbs and so forth, but it's kind of like if there's holidays, we get extra food. So my question to you, the Chef Besh, is because how you said you had the volunteer chefs, I mean, did they also like volunteer food? I mean, how did you feed all these homeless people? Like, for instance, we never know how much we're going to have, and so sometimes we have to say you really have to limit your food, when you go up to get the food at the table. And so I'm just wondering, when you did this, how did you get the chefs to cooperate? How did you get the extra ingredient? I mean, did you personally donate that? Or how did you get all this food to feed vast amounts of people?
Well, it was for a limited amount of time. And so it wasn't in perpetuity of that we're just feeding people on in. The chefs that came back, everybody in my group, I told them, take as much time as you need, but I need you back. And if you can get back, I'll pay you today. And if you come back tomorrow, I'll still pay you for today. And the food we donated, the food we used, our resources, we twisted arms, we marshaled the resources that we needed in order just to get the job done. once that job was finished, the oil companies moved back into town, and they needed contracts for food for their people so that they could get the refineries up and running. And I charged them through the nose. We love charging oil companies. When that happened, I still thought I was going out of business. I thought we were ruined, fine dining, we'll never return to New Orleans. I'm gonna do the best I can and I'm gonna go down with the sinking ship. I made a deal with all those that came back that I would split the profits. And to hand a $100,000 check over to a cook that's never made more than $10 an hour changed his life. And so to see in them having that faith in me and us reciprocating just changed the course of our entire company. And there were profits along the way. And so as we profited, think of it as a sense of stewardship that the entire company started buying into. And so whenever we needed to, we just had flooding in Baton Rouge. It just moved me to see every gal from all parts of the office. I don't know where the guys were. The guys were all cooking. The girls all went and started gutting all these houses. And it was amazing. It was just, nobody even had to ask. People just volunteered. Sign me up. Let's go do this. And so it's interesting the way the stewardship tends to work. It attracts like-minded people. And that's, you know, how we've done things. And it's worked.
Okay. Did you also find that it built a better sense of community? Like, for instance, like, some people were saying, like, downtown South Bend, walking around, aren't you nervous? Like, I'm like, no, because a lot of these homeless people I know, because I fed them, and they're like, hey, how are you doing? So did you find that, too, that there was a better sense of pulling everybody together in your...
Exactly, and I think it was a sense of hospitality that brought, you know, that reestablished a multi-billion dollar business in our town that had been known for hospitality. That's the only thing that resurrected our city. And what hospitality does is it builds community. That's how, and it strengthens. And so it's just amazing today to walk through the streets of parts of New Orleans that we would have never ventured in today, or before the storm, and today they're hustling and bustling, full of commerce and lots of love.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, I just had a question. About your general philosophies. I know, Alex, you said like finding things in nature is always like a helpful, inspirational part of the way you cook. And I know Chef Besh also always says like use whatever's fresh and whatever's lying around. And as like a busy graduate student, sometimes I find it's really hard to get fresh ingredients all the time. And I really enjoy cooking and I want to make it a part of my life. And I'm just wondering if there's any like tips you have, as if you can't have like a garden in the back of your house with like fresh ingredients all the time, like what do you suggest doing to make that culinary experience so beautiful?
Well, I would say, and something that I try and do at home a lot is building a really good pantry. And what that means specifically is get a lot of things that don't perish. I mean, I think off the top of my head, like, you can buy such really great Spanish anchovies or something packed in oil where you can make a meal out of these things, pastas and all that kind of obvious stuff. But in my own home, I've really started cooking a lot of dishes in the same idea, focusing on things like Chinese dishes that require a lot of these kind of things that aren't going to perish, non-perishable goods that you can put together and create something really flavorful and really delicious that you can always have and just know when you walk into the kitchen that it's there. But yeah, that's all I got with that.
A great pantry is a wonderful thing. And I'll be sending you some cookbooks that we need to get around your address. I love food that tells a story. You can delve into it any which way, but and all food does in some way, shape, or form. There is a story behind it. And so I'm passionate about cooking, you know, those things that take long hours to cook and to coax all these incredible flavors out of. Oftentimes, the cheapest things in the world to, you know, to cook are the hardest and, quite frankly, taste the best. Coming from a place where we eat red beans and rice every Monday, I love those old classics that, you know, like, okay, this is a food from a place. I think probably the most underrated and the most accessible food style of cooking, and especially affordable for a grad student, is Italian. And so the first thing that hit me was like, you just have to cook Italian.
Yeah.
And so anyway, but it's fun, and I just encourage you to, like, if you're obviously passionate about food, just to delve in, roll up your sleeves, and see where it takes you.
Thank you.
Up top.
Question. If anybody didn't hear what he said, he's asking what's the relationship between creativity and kind of being obedient to maybe the traditions or to the product. It's a good question. It's I think with the explosion of farm-to-table cooking in the United States and this kind of return to this almost more pastoral cuisine that you see popping up all over, where you look at a menu and you see the farm in which the tomatoes came from and where the meat was from and all of this, you almost see that people are, chefs are becoming a little more subjective to the product itself. But then I spoke of two men who seemingly threw the book out and did all of what they wanted. Not sure, maybe you can elaborate.
So, you're not going to pass this off on me. He's asking you, right? I think, and again, it really comes down to two schools, but why do they have to be at odds with each other? And so, yeah, I can respect both. I crave both. I just crave them at different times. And I think that I've never met a cook, and I hate the word chef, I've never met a cook who wasn't inspired by walking through their favorite market. Jennifer and I, for years, would walk through the the Wednesday market in Saint Clement de Provence, and to see the beautiful artichokes, where you could do so many things. You may just want to slice them in half and grill them for a moment, a little bit of olive oil, sea salt, and some lemon, and that in and of itself is perfect. And so I don't think they have to be at odds with one another. I think that I love both of them in equal proportion.
I want to touch on it just again, because there is something interesting in this topic, that is, when you get the artichoke or whatever it may be, and you want to do something creative with it, are you creating from a point of true creation, or is it something that you've kind of seen, or when you look at a certain product, do you feel like it must go this route because it kind of always has? So, and I'm just posing questions at this point, but all
and food
things.
Is plagiarism at its best.
Of course. Jeff.
A friend of mine, Angel Mendez Montoya, wrote a book called The Theology of Food, and in the first chapter he describes, he's Mexican, and he describes, he's a Dominican brother, and he's, I guess he's a professor somewhere in Mexico City. And he describes the making of a mole. And he's an amateur, he's a professional theologian, but he's an amateur cook. And all of us, or most of us in this room, are gonna be amateur cooks. But he describes how this is, he's making this mole, and then at the end of it, his friends all arrive and they are engaging in this kind of sacramental eating of the mole. So what I wanna hear from both of you is the times when the amateurs impressed you. So if somebody from your family made something, what did they do to impress you? Just as an amateur, you guys with such refined palates and all of this knowledge, what did they do to impress you? And what can we then learn from that? What did they do, the people, amateurs, to impress you?
I think I've been more impressed by experiencing just as chefs, as professionals, we know what goes into making that great mole and how simple it can be and yet how complex it is, and just the toasting of each, of each spice before it's ground is so vital and important. And so I think having this insight makes me appreciate even the simplest dish. And no joke, one of the best meals I've ever had in my life was in South Bend at his house. And do you remember those steaks, Brendy? I mean, the perfectly cooked steak, just a little bit of sea salt over the top. My kids running everywhere, your kids going crazy, and it was just like this, everything. It was just, and I know how hard it is to, simplicity is sometimes the hardest thing. It's easy to create something very complicated, and it's very difficult to season something perfectly, throw it on the grill, pull it off, and allow it to exist. So I think professional chefs, more often than not, are the most appreciative over the simplest of meals cooked by people they love.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. And I'm gonna put my colleague and boss, Abe Scherter, on the spot with, after leaving working for Thomas Keller and the French Laundry, which is all so very, everything is pushed into molds and everything is not the shape that it should be. Cooking with him, seeing whole dishes that have two ingredients being served to 80 people, and it kills. And it's always super good. And it was the first time that I had someone say, oh, you're allowed to just cook whatever you want to cook. It doesn't have to all be kind of forced and pushed into a certain direction and just kind of serving these simple things. I really think that's, going back to the question of the pantry, having these few five or six really good items that you can lean on to make these simple dishes, that's the best cooking there is.
I have a question about the accessibility of wine. And what I mean by accessibility is, so for food, I think Julia Child telling the American public, this is what souffle is. So even if they're not making it at home, it's not just the rich people who know what souffle is. So Julia Child, and then of course now with the advent of so many different television programs about food, it seems like the public understands food in a way that it didn't, let's say, pre-television. So my question is actually about wine, because let's think about the 1980s. Finally, maybe people are drinking wine, and the pink wine they're drinking is White Zinfandel. Now they're drinking rosé. What happened to the general public's appreciation of wine so that they're not drinking pink wine that tastes like fruit juice?
Well, there's a lot to that timeline, but there's certainly, wine is so difficult because it's like reading about jazz. You can only read so much. You have to actually, open that bottle or put on that record. That's making it harder and harder for so many to know what the great wines of the world taste like, just because they're too expensive. And that's where I think we're seeing a lot of these kind of secondary markets come out of the woodwork. You see places like Georgia and Slovenia and all these countries having wines in American restaurants. As far as the changing American palate and the landscape, I'm sure a lot of that has to do with importers and distribution channels. I live really close to this shop called Kermit Lynch in Berkeley, California, which really was one of the first Americans to bring in these French wines that are now, you know, some of these bottles are way over $1,000 a bottle. But it's these little tiny incremental changes you see with just kind of the overall landscape of what's available. Because a lot of these wines, when Riesling that was sweet and sold in a blue bottle, those just weren't, the wines just weren't in the country. So I think a lot of it has to be on their shoulders and changing palates. And maybe the work, as you spoke, that food is now becoming so more known about, and restaurants are something to be cherished and talked about. Wine kind of goes with that a little bit.
I think I'd love to piggyback on part of that. To open a bottle of wine is to experience it. I can YouTube any recipe that I could ever imagine. I've got to experience the wine just like music. Unfortunately, we're all programmed by marketing that has us thinking, more often than not, in French varietals, at least the Venus vinifera, the noble grapes, right? And so very few of us know much outside of those, and that's where, you know, you look into the Greek wine or Italian wines are terribly simple, but very difficult to understand because we're not programmed to think that way. We're thinking of German wines. The Germans have done a great job of marketing blue nut. No offense, sister. And so we're programmed that this is good, this is right. How often do you ask, what kind of wine should I drink with this?
All the
one that you enjoy. And for us to maybe remove this mantle of I'm supposed to act like this, or I'm supposed to eat that, or I'm supposed to drink this, and just live and love and enjoy it and take a risk. If you don't know it, order it. Let's find out what it is together, kind of a thing.
Yeah.
And that's the fun, I think, of really discovering wine.
I think this will be our last question, yes.
So my question is kind of about food in relation to beauty and culture, I guess. So I've been blessed to be able to visit places like Spain and Italy and France where the beauty isn't just in the food, but it's in the time and it's in the culture and it's in spending time with your family. And I've had some of the worst meals of my life in those places with the best people I could ever be with, and that's what made it beautiful. And so I'm seeing, and I think everyone can agree that the American conception of a meal in a restaurant is pretty different than those places where you spend up to 3 hours, maybe four, with numerous bottles of wine and those perfectly cooked steaks. So can you speak a little bit to that, like our culture? Are we losing something? Or do you think that there's something to gain with the American hustle and bustle restaurant culture that we have?
I think we have lost large swaths of our culture. Some of them maybe, I don't know, you know, that's something to ponder on, whether or not we can just regain the family. Because it's at the family table that we act, where cultures are formed, where cultures are, you know, that's the building block, right? And so if we lose the idea of how, much less not even cooking, but just eating together, it's such a critical part of our, of that, of building on culture. We've lost that. Don't know if we're gonna get that back. Only time will tell. But what we have are different spheres where you have those with the means to go to fine restaurants and to have and to experience certain things. And I see we're a lot more food conscious today than ever before. We know more food terminology than ever before. Yet we're cooking less today than we've ever cooked before. And we're eating unhealthier today. So you have one element of our society who are doing pretty good. They're eating better, they're talking food, wine, life is just wonderful. Then you have this massive swath of our society that is just fed crap, and they're not eating together, so they're not even, by not eating together as a family, per se, that you're not even being nourished by the different social elements. And so we're losing all sorts of nourishment by losing that table. And so I don't know where that really leaves me, other than I'm gonna continue cooking for people, try to make a few dollars at a time so I can pay it to Notre Dame. And you really do need a big return on the investment. And at the same time, continue to fill my TV shows, encouraging people to get back into the kitchen and get back to the table. And I don't know what you think.
Yeah, I think I agree completely. And I can only just hope that it feels like there's a new gourmet grocery store opening up all the time. And all this focus put on cooking and cookbooks and all of this, I just hope that will translate within a generation to cooking at home and bringing people back around the table. So, hope, I guess.
All right, thank you both very much, and thank you all.